This is Where Did the Road Go? Our aim is to explore the fringe, to be true skeptics and question openly, to investigate the paranormal, bring light to the dark corners of history, and give a voice to the shunned of science. We deal in mystery and the important questions that these subjects bring to light. What is reality? Who are we? And why are we here? Join us on the web at wheredidtheroadgo.com for a full show archive, links to all our social media, upcoming schedule, and much, much more. Now, join your host Soraya on this week's edition of Where Did the Road Go?
And welcome to the show. This week we're talking to Jim Harold as he tells us some of the tales from his true ghost stories, Jim Harold's Campfire, Volume 4. And of course we discuss a little bit about what might actually be happening in some of these stories, as we always do when he's on. Now, we didn't have enough time to go over all the stories I wanted to talk about, so if you're a Patreon, you'll get the extra 3 or 4 that we didn't get to in the show. And if you want to become a Patreon, all past content is also still available if you become a Patreon. So it's only $3 a month. It helps us out, and it's going to help us bring you more and more content. And once again, I want to stress, since every once in a while people don't seem to understand this, there are no full interviews on the Patreon thing. We're not making you pay for interviews. What you get on Patreon is some extra segments with people who are on the main show. So like in this case with Jim Harold, you're getting a few extra stories by being a Patreon and supporting the show. When we have merchandise, you'll be getting stuff at a discount if you want it. And hopefully that's going to be sooner rather than later. We may have some freebies to give out to you, book-wise, and maybe some other stuff as well. And all in all, you help us continue to bring you more content. So, again, if you want to become a Patreon, wheredidtheroadgo.com. It's right there at the top, or middle. I guess it's in the middle of the page, under the logo. All right, and without any further ado, let's hear some true ghost stories. So I am here with Jim Harold, and you have yet another campfire book out, Jim.
Yes, yes. Last fall, I came out with my latest Campfire 4, and again, 70 more spooky stories that come from my, if people aren't familiar, I do a podcast called Jim Harold's Campfire. Been doing it since 2009. And what we do is every year we compile some stories, usually about 70 stories, into a book. And so far they've been very well received. And I love being able to share these stories. And thank you for the opportunity tonight to share some stories with your audience.
And this one's bigger. They keep getting bigger as you put them out.
Yeah, I always want to bring more value. No, but the thing is for example, you know, on the Kindle store, this book is $2.99. And I think when people see that, they think, oh, this is, you know, this is 30 or 40 pages. This is a pamphlet. And this is a full-length book. It clocks in usually, the books usually go about 260, 270 pages. I know you have a hard copy, so you can attest to that. So it's yes. It's a full-length book. And I think that if you like ghost stories, and not only ghost stories, I mean, we call Jim Harold's Campfire True Ghost Stories but it really is a mixture of stories, maybe predominantly ghost stories, but we talk about a lot of supernatural things on the campfire, and it's reflected in the books.
All right, yeah, and this one you have actually broken up into different sections of different things like UFOs and shadow people and things like that.
Yes, yes. And you know, that's the thing that amazed me. When I started doing the show back in 2009, first of all, I didn't think that people would have the emotional attachment they've had to the show, which really kind of shocked me, because I thought, oh, this will just be fun. But people say, you know, this is a story I've never told anybody. This makes me feel like I can share my story. And the other thing that has kind of surprised me is the diversity of stories. Now, I don't know if we're talking about one of these tonight, but we have doppelganger stories. Certainly, I think one of the stories we'll probably talk about tonight is a shadow person story. And kind of the diversity of stories is what really surprised me, because I thought it would just be, you know, Aunt Millie visiting to check in. And that's certainly a part of it. And I don't want to downplay that because I love those kind of stories. And I love those poignant kind of family stories. But it's an extremely diverse group of stories. And just as soon as I think that I've heard everything, somebody will call up and will tell me a story that totally blows me away and is unlike anything I've ever heard before.
Yeah, you have some really interesting ones in here. And those are the ones that always intrigue me the most, are the really weird ones, the high strangeness stories. I mean,
yes,
the ghost stories are interesting for what they are. And some of them were very unique in their own rights. But like when you get to some of the high strangeness ones that we're going to talk about tonight, like the man in red and such, it's some really weird stuff.
Yeah, and the thing is that, you know, for the most part, I think the people who call the show are very sincere in their belief that something strange has happened to them. Now, it's called true ghost stories. Somebody asked me, well, do you know that they're true? Well, I can't go out and personally investigate every story to make sure it's, quote, true. But I do believe these people believe something strange happened to them. And and the stories I picked for the book are specifically ones where I think people are being very forthcoming, and some of them are just really, really weird. I mean, I've had people who have called the show and said they saw a leprechaun and they got validation from a family member that they saw it too, or what they thought was a leprechaun. Now, that seems on the face of it, and I'll use a word, and I don't mean it to disparage people, crazy. But the truth is that you listen to this person, and they're talking about something that happened, you know, 46 years ago, about the time I was born, and you could tell the emotion coming back to them. So I don't think they're lying. I think they're telling the truth and interpreting things and sharing them as they happen to them.
Well, I also suspect that with the paranormal, especially certain aspects of the paranormal, we're seeing... we're perhaps encountering something we don't have a correct face for.
Right.
So our brain just kind of interprets it however it can. So it's a leprechaun. Well, it may not have actually been a leprechaun, but it looked like a leprechaun to them because their brain went, what the hell is that?
Yeah, you try to fit it in.
Leprechaun, you know?
Yeah, try to fit it into a known pattern. You know, so yeah, absolutely. I think that makes all the sense in the world, and I think that is what you're seeing a lot of times.
So let's start with just a classic ghost story, the one of Big Dora, because I found this one really interesting.
Yes, this one's from Steve in the United Kingdom, and that's a nice part of the show that we do get a lot of people from overseas, particularly the UK. And this was about his daughter, Isla. She was 2.5 years old, and she started having these experiences, and she started talking about someone by the name of Big Dora. For example, one night about midnight, this little girl woke up screaming, Steve says, and the father said, what's wrong? She said, Big Dora shouted at me. And he thought quite naturally that she was talking about the cartoon character Dora the Explorer. He said she couldn't take her hands off her eyes, and she tried to take them off, and his daughter wouldn't let him. Said that Big Dora kept shouting at her. And this kept going on and on. One night, Isla was talking to the front door, and he started listening. His wife actually brought the phone over. He wasn't home. And it turns out that his daughter was talking again to Big Dora. And over the next few months, this Dora character became an obsession with Isla. And it got to the point where she wouldn't walk through the house by herself, that they had to pick her up and carry her wherever she went. She would scream quite a lot that Big Dora was there and shouting at her. Then something strange happened to Steve. He was sitting in the living room all alone. He was watching a documentary on television. It was nighttime. I think everybody was in bed. And out of the left-hand corner of his eye, there was a shadow figure that walked across where the curtains were, and it actually kind of morphed almost into the shape of a, strangely enough, the shape of a tornado. And all of these things kept going on, and he said, we've got to find out what's going on here. So he called in some psychics and some mediums. And when the mediums came, his daughter was in the yard, in the garden, as they say over there. He let the mediums in, and his daughter came running in the house, and she said, I can hear Big Dora. I can see Big Dora. Or no, that's what she usually said. But this time, apparently, she was saying, no, no, no. And Dora didn't want to go, and she didn't want to talk to the mediums. And it turned out that Big Dora went upstairs. So they followed her. And this was in Steve's bedroom, right in front of his bedroom wardrobe. And the medium said, just concentrate, just be quiet. They stood there, and all of a sudden, the room became freezing cold, but it was August. And the mediums were muttering away. Steve wasn't sure what they were saying. And then it was like someone closed a freezer door. The room warmed up, and the mediums opened their eyes, and they said, she's gone. A little fat man came and took her away. They explained to Steve that the reason the Big Dora was here was because Isla reminded her of her own daughter. So they decided to do some research. And, you know, Dora, when she was upset, would always leave the house. And it turned out that he got a letter after doing some historical work from a historian, sent her a photograph. It was from 1944. Turns out that his house had been shelled by the Germans just before the end of the war. And in this email, he got the information that there was a lady who lived next door. And she died during the shelling, and her name was Dora Smith. Now, that's pretty chilling. And essentially, they were able to piece it together that's why she would always go to the neighbors. She would always go out on that side of the house. And all these weird things would happen. The electricity would go out and so forth. And again, the thought is that the thought was that she was sticking around because this little girl reminded her of her own daughter. And it's interesting, that wardrobe, the bedroom that she left out of when those mediums were there, faces the house directly next door where Dora Smith lived. So Steve told us about Big Dora, all kinds of electrical problems, all kinds of strange things. The little girl said something like there was fire and the house was broken and Dora's trapped and she can't get out. It can't get out. And that all maps to the idea of a bombing. So just a very, very strange thing, Big Dora.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. And, you know, I'm not always convinced that these things are ghosts or spirits of the dead. Sometimes I think they're masquerading. But in a case like that, I think the best explanation is spirit of the dead.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with you. The other thing that always occurs to me is this idea of the stone tape theory, like a replay. Now, I think these mediums were saying that was not the case. In this case, she said that Dora was visiting because of this little girl. But I always wonder, are you seeing some kind of psychic replay of some type? That's one of the more interesting theories, at least to me.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. And but at the same time, if they're interacting with you, it's obviously not a replay.
True. Exactly.
Let's move on to Can You Hear Me?
Yes, this is about a house where a lot of strange things happen. This was Melissa in Illinois. And she said before her family owned the family home, a man named George died in the house in the 1980s. He had a heart attack in his living room. And sadly, he sat there for about 3 days before he was discovered. And it was particularly heartbreaking for her parents because they had been friends. Although it was a very sad situation for them, eventually her family decided to purchase the home because her mom had lived in the neighborhood her entire life. They cleaned the house up. They moved in, and a couple of years later, Melissa was born. Now, she said that she's always had this kind of weird way about her. She was born on Christmas, so the big joke was that she was kind of different from everyone else. And she said when she was around the age of three, she would look over into the hallway of the house and ask, who are those men? Now, her parents would look at her and say, what on earth are we talking about? And she said she still remembers it today, which is actually unique because usually kids forget this kind of stuff. She says she recalls seeing these green men standing in the hallway. She said they would walk back and forth and would look at her. And her parents thought she was weird. She remembered thinking, what the heck is going on? Why are they looking at me? She said no one believed her, so she just went on with life. Also, when lying in her parents' bed, she would look up and tell them that she could see angels flying over the bed. And she said when her mom was pregnant with her younger brother and didn't know it yet, she sat straight up and said to her, a baby's coming. And her mom said, excuse me? And she said, a baby's coming. Someone told me. Sure enough, a couple of weeks later, she learned that her mom was pregnant. Now, exactly who told Melissa this information, she doesn't know. She just sat up and said it. She said it was weird. And she says, fast forward to a couple of years back. She had started to get back into the paranormal, and she began looking into it because she would always hear bumps in the night around the house. She said she knows that sounds generic, but she swore there was always something different about her home. She said this would happen in the evening. She would hear people walking around both upstairs and down. She says they have two cats, so she just assumed it was them until one night she realized that both of the cats were lying in her bed. Then she knew something wasn't right. She said on this one particular evening about 2 years ago, she was upstairs with her mom at about 10 or 11 o'clock. She said it was very nice outside, so they had the windows open. And she was talking on the phone with a friend. She heard this banging outside. She wondered what in the world was going on. Her mom asked, did you hear that? They looked around, and at one point, her mom shushed her because she was being very serious about it. And they don't know where it came from, but all of a sudden, she said, someone came up to her and said, can you hear me? And there was no one there. She said it was the creepiest thing she had ever heard or experienced. She literally thought someone was behind her. And she called out to her brother, and it wasn't him. And it seems like it's not just her. Whatever this is seems to be communicating with her brother too. As he's getting older, whenever he's home alone, he'll hear someone saying, Danny. She says it comes from upstairs, but no one is there. He's starting to hear bumps in the night as well, and it is creeping him out. Now, she's not sure if this is all connected to George, who died in the house. From what she's heard, he was a gentle soul. So she doesn't feel it's negative, but she feels like someone is walking around their home. And she thinks it very well could be connected to George. And she's thinking about doing other investigation, but we'll see where that all leads.
Yeah, and I like the weirdness of that one with the green men and such.
Yeah, it's interesting because it's not just limited. It's not just limited to George. It's not just there's other things going on. Definitely.
And it's funny how we react to things. I mean, because if you had something that was trying to communicate and it says, you know, can you hear me? It's obvious. It's likely not meant to creep us out, but the effect, I mean, even just hearing the story gives you the creeps.
Oh, absolutely. And the thing is that I think, look at it, let's say that there are such things as spirits trying to communicate with us. It would be very difficult to find a way in which to communicate that would be non-threatening, because anything would pretty much scare the bejesus out of us. So I don't really know. If you're a ghost and you're trying to communicate, it's like, okay, how can I do this without frightening this person within an inch of their life? And I think that's would be a very hard thing to do. And that's something that I ask psychics all the time. You know, if our loved ones or spirit wants to communicate with us, why don't they just come out and communicate with us? And the answer I always get back, it's difficult. It's not that easy. And they communicate in the ways that they can. So whether that's the case or not, I don't know. I don't know the answers. I just ask the questions and take the stories. But it's certainly interesting thinking about it and asking those questions.
All right. Let's move on to one of the Shadow Men stories.
Yes. There actually is this one is a shocking shadow. Now, this is really weird. This is really weird. This happened to, I probably mispronounced her name, Yulita from Connecticut. And she was attending school in Chicago. And she was actually living in a old hotel that had been converted into dormitories down near the Loop area, if you're familiar with Chicago at all. And she had a boyfriend, and he lived in a dorm, but he lived with a boisterous bunch. So a lot of times when her roommate was away, the boyfriend would stay over. And they had bunk beds. They all each had their own bed. And basically, the boyfriend fell asleep right away. And she was just lying there and thinking. She said she noticed something strange. She looked up at the ceiling. All of a sudden, in the corner of it, right above her head, a black shadow appeared. And she thought, oh, it must be somebody out in the hall. So she peeked over the bed. And there was no one there. Nothing flashing by the door, and she looked back up, and the shadow was getting larger. She thought it was pretty odd. Now, the window, the only window in the room, would face the brick wall of another building. They always had the blinds down, so there wasn't any light coming there. There was no light under the door, and the more that she looked at this shadow, the more it seemed strange. It started moving across the ceiling, getting darker and darker, blacker and blacker. She said it began to almost look as if someone spilled a bottle of ink. She said it was such a deep black that you couldn't mistake what it was. It started spreading across the ceiling, and that's when she began to decide this isn't normal. It got bigger. She got scared. She said the shadow was almost over the whole bed, and she nudged her boyfriend to wake up. And she'd never had paranormal experiences up to this time. She said the most she'd ever heard of were apparitions, ghosts, and maybe poltergeists. She never heard of the idea of shadow people. She didn't know what was happening. She started to nudge her boyfriend to wake up, and right then, the figure shot back into itself and disappeared right back into the corner of the ceiling where it had come from. Her boyfriend finally woke up and basically gave her the old, "Oh, you were just dreaming" routine. And she tried to explain to him to no avail. And he said, well, go back to sleep. So she was still very scared. She put the covers over her head like a little kid, hoping that if she'd lie really still, it won't come back. Then she did fall asleep and she had a dream. It was extremely lucid, very vivid, she says. She was standing in the same dorm room. Everything was exactly as it was in real life, except the lights were on and she was standing by the door. Her boyfriend was up in the bunk bed and he was yelling at her in this dream, but she couldn't hear what he was saying. Everything was happening in slow motion. Eventually, she started to hear him speaking and he was saying, "Turn off the light, turn off the light, turn off the light before it gets you." So in the dream, she turned toward the light switch that was by the door, and this black inky thing in the dream was moving across the wall. And as she reached for the light to turn off, the black inky thing reached the light switch at the same time. And as she touched the light switch, the inky thing touched her. And then she felt a massive shock of electricity. And she started falling backwards in slow motion in her dream. And as she fell backward, she woke up. At that point, she woke up in pitch darkness, unable to move, completely frozen, with a shock going up and down her body. She said she tried to scream and move her hands, and she couldn't. She had no idea that how long that lasted. She said it felt like 5 minutes, but it could have been one. And by the time she got her voice back, she started yelling. And the very time, and this is, sorry, this is what gets me. At the very same time, her boyfriend started yelling, and he shot up in bed. And she was trying to explain what happened. And he was trying to tell her something too. Finally, he told her that he had been dreaming a vivid dream as well. In it, the black thing I had told him about was moving across the covers of the bed. In his dream, it had gotten under the covers and touched him. When that happened, he said he got shocked by what he described as electricity. It was exactly the same time of feeling that Yulita was feeling. And he said when that happened, he woke up, but he couldn't move or speak either. Now, they ended up leaving the room wisely. They grabbed their pillows and spent the rest of the night in the dorm room with his crazy roommate. And she said she had a few days where she was afraid to be there, but eventually that feeling passed and she went back. And she never had that experience there again. And years later, she said she ran into someone else who had been living in that building with the same year on a different floor. And they were at a Halloween party, strangely enough, and they were swapping weird stories. And she said, "Oh my God, I've had experiences in that building too." And there's a question about the hotel, you know, that people had seen an apparition of a girl in the lounge and so forth. But the one thing she does say very pointedly is that she thinks this entity would have done physical harm if it had the chance. And she says, in a way, she feels that her and her boyfriend were attacked physically, but it could have been worse. She said it was spooky. What really caps it off to me is the fact that she had the validation from her boyfriend. I've heard of this before, boyfriend, girlfriend having the same dream at the same time and waking up and telling each other about it. We've had that kind of story before. And that is high strangeness, very weird stuff.
Yeah, and there's also some elements of sleep paralysis in there,
yes,
as well.
Yes, absolutely. And she said that she doesn't believe it's sleep paralysis because it happened to both of them. So take that for what it's worth.
Well, I don't always think that sleep paralysis is as simple as the scientific explanation makes it out to be.
Right.
But we're actually going to do a show on that at some point.
It's a fascinating topic.
And I've actually had something similar happen without the shocking part. I had woken up one day, middle of the day, because I'm nocturnal, so I'd woken up and it was bright and sunny in the room,
right,
at least what was coming through the blinds and such. And I realized there was this liquid black shadow on my ceiling.
Ooh.
And it just kept moving around, and I watched it, and apparently eventually I just fell back asleep.
Yeah.
And the number of times weird things have happened to me that should have creeped me out, and I just eventually said, okay, well, I'm going to go back to sleep now. I can't even count. And later I think, why did I go back to sleep?
Yeah, yeah, that's a good question. And you kind of hit it on the head early on when you said high strangeness, because there's some of these stories, there's really not a satisfying end to, or like neatly wrapped in a bow. They're what I call the head scratchers that just kind of make you think, what in the world was that? And certainly that's one, and I know some of the other ones we're going to talk about, but those are the ones that kind of leave you unsatisfied from the sense that, well, what was that? You know, it's not neatly put in a box like seeing Aunt Millie or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah, well, let's go with one of the really weird ones, which was Queen of the Dragonflies.
Yes, that's exactly one of the ones I was thinking of when I just said that. And actually, this is from Sandy from California, who probably also had another one of my very favorite. She has some great stories that have happened to her. But this one goes back to when she was around 10 years old and she was visiting her grandparents' farm in western Pennsylvania. And she said it was a very beautiful farm and so forth. Now, they were there for dinner, but it wasn't time to eat yet. So her and her little brother decided to kill some time. So they just meandered out back and walked along the water. I assume there was some type of stream back there. It wasn't very wide. Her brother was on one side of the pond and she was on the other. She said they were looking at the minnows and the tadpoles and everything. She said it was early fall because the willow trees were starting to lose their greenness. And she said there was no tall grass or anything like that, very well manicured and taken care of. So there wouldn't have been a lot of bugs and things like that around. She said they were kind of standing there. Now, out of the corner of her eye, she said that she saw this massive bug. And she says they were watching dragonflies and damselflies flit about, but this bug was beyond anything she'd ever seen. She said this, she's going to say, she said the head, seriously. And she said, this is going to sound kind of crazy, even for me, but the head was about the size of a softball. The body just came out of the head, and the body was anywhere from 12 to 18 inches long. It had four wings like a dragonfly, but the coloration was more like a yellow jacket, where it had clearly defined yellow and black stripes. The head was yellow, and because from where she was standing, the sun was behind her, she said she could see the sun shining off of this, so it was a very shiny exoskeleton, so to speak, she says. She said this thing came buzzing out. Her brother's eyes were as big as saucers, and his mouth was wide open. She asked him, "Do you see this?" And he just kind of nodded and said, "Yes." And she asked her brother, "Is this a toy? What is this thing?" And he said he didn't know. And they started looking around for somebody actually physically flying something. Now, Sandy says, you know, she's, you know, I'm guessing she's probably in her 50s, I'm guessing. And she said back in the day, the only thing that you saw radio control, it's not like now with drones and things, were those really noisy gasoline-powered airplanes. Right? She said the ones where you take 6 months to build and you break it in 5 minutes of getting it off the ground. but she said, and they were really noisy. But she said, this was buzzing, but it wasn't noisy like that. And she said she had studied bugs, so she knew the anatomy of a bug. But this one was strange. She said either the thorax was really thick or straight, and it went down into a tail. And he said it was very odd. It had six legs and an antenna. And she said she watched it come around from the pond, and the bug came around her again, and she looked at it wondering, what is this thing? She thought about it almost being something prehistoric. And that's when she dubbed it the Queen of the Dragonflies. She said it had four wings, and even though it didn't really look like a dragonfly, except for that, that's where her mind went at that age. And she said it was very, very quiet. And at one point, this thing came at her, and it just stopped and hovered in front of her face. She said, you know how sometimes a hummingbird or a bee will think that you're a big flower and checks you out? She said, it was that kind of thing. And he said it was about 2.5 or 3 feet away. For a moment, it may have thought I was supper, she said. Now, I don't know about you, Soraya, but if I had a fly with a head the size of a softball in front of me, I would be running way, way, way out. And then they really didn't, it kept fluttering around, flying around, and then it disappeared. Now, the interesting thing is that they never saw it again. They talked about it. And the thing is that after a certain age, they stopped talking about it. Now, at the time of Sandy telling this, which has been a few years ago, but she said, for some strange reason last year, the memory came back to me. And she was going to talk to her little brother about it just to verify. She had the idea of coming on the show and telling me this story. And she said to him, hey, Jack, do you remember the time we were down by the pond and there was that bug? And he said, I don't remember that. I don't know what you're talking about. And nope, I don't want to talk. I don't like bugs. I don't want to talk about it. And apparently her brother's a pretty brave guy, but he was absolutely terrified of it. She started to sketch it out. And he said, no, I'm not even going to look at it. Don't even bother drawing it. I'm not going to look at it. And he just was very, very, very frightened of this. And what made me wonder about this, and she actually had a drawing, I probably should have put it in the book, is maybe this is some kind of screen memory for something else. Obviously your listeners will probably be familiar with the idea of a screen memory where something is supposedly projected onto your memory to screen, thus the name, something, some other memory out. But to me, I mean, that sounds pretty incredible, but Sandy seems to be very sincere in this. I believe something very, very strange happened. What it could be, I don't know.
Yeah, and I mean, the screen memory can also be created by the brain that doesn't want to remember something else as well.
Right.
But it's also, and again, with that us trying to fit things into categories that our brain can figure out, it might also be that some of this stuff, you know, like it picks from us as much as we project onto it. So
right.
This could have been some weird pile of energy, and once they saw it, they started creating its shape, hence why they both saw the same thing.
Right.
But who knows? I mean, it's so hard to even get under this stuff.
And the thing about it that I thought was interesting was that her brother, who she says is kind of a really brave guy about most things, was just adamant about not going.
Yeah.
And that to me says, you know, this was traumatic to him in some way.
Yeah. Even if he honestly doesn't remember it, he doesn't want to remember it.
Right. Exactly.
Let's jump over to one of the UFO stories. Let's do a UFO deja vu.
UFO deja vu, yes.
And I have an intro. One of the things in here is very interesting. So,
well, this is from Chris from South Carolina, and he had two experiences he'd like to share. And he said it's out of sequence, but he wants to share the most dramatic first. And he said the strangest experience he had was in 1994. He was about 15 years old, quite a bit younger than me. And he said they just finished eating dinner at a Chinese restaurant with his family. And they were on their way home. Now, they lived out in the country. So he was looking out the window. And on our left-hand side, they saw the strange light up in the sky. And he said there were some hills on the road. And as we reached the top of one and started going down the hill, I could see there was something in the sky sitting right about at treetop level. And he said he caught the attention of his family and said, look out the window. Everyone looked, and his father stopped the car immediately. There was a triangle UFO floating right above the treetops and a pond that was there. The UFO was probably about the size of a football field, and it had a white light on each corner. That sounds like those Belgian UFOs, if you remember that outbreak in the 90s. And he said the funny thing about this was that it was not the first time he had seen something like this, which he's going to talk about later. But the UFO was completely black, and like he said, it had a white light on each corner. His mom was terrified, hysterical. His brother and he were stunned, but they got out of the car anyway. His dad said that they would leave them there, which wouldn't be the first thing I would do. But anyway, his dad said that he would leave them there, take mom back home, and come back with a camera and return. So they went home. The brother and our caller are there and watching this thing. And he said that it was summertime because you could hear frogs and crickets, but the UFO was completely silent. It just floated there. And he said it was maybe 100 feet high, so very visible. He said his brother and he sat there for a couple of minutes looking at this thing, and they got really afraid. They started running up the road towards their house. And he said as you went down one hill, you had to go up another hill to get back to their home. And as they ran up the hill, the craft started following them. I mean, that, you know, I mean, it's bad enough that you're seeing this crazy kind of thing. And all of a sudden it's following you. Could you imagine that? That would be really, really scary. So
yeah.
So anyway, they started running back to their house. And they had gotten only about 300 yards from their house when their dad came speeding down the driveway. He pulled right up to where our caller and his brother were, and they're standing in the middle of the road. And just as he got there, the craft took off at a fairly high speed and headed back into the treetops. He said he saw the direction, which must have been westerly, and they got in the car with his father. And they had the camera, and they spent 45 minutes to an hour chasing this object, hoping it would become stationary again to get a picture. But it never did. Now, the interesting thing is, he says this wasn't the first time he'd seen something like this. When he was about 5 or 6, they lived in a small town in Sanford, North Carolina. And he was awoken one night at about 3 a.m. He said they lived right next to Fort Bragg. And his brother and he were used to seeing jets flying over the treetops. And when they heard the jets flying, they would run out to see them. And he said they flew so low that you could almost read the bottom wing markings on them. He said he was guessing they're doing low flying radar evasion exercises or something like that. He said one night he was awoken by a loud rumbling sound and he looked out the window. He said they lived on a big hill, so their window sat pretty much right at tree level. And they looked out the window and guess what they saw? They saw the point of a triangle. He said this time it wasn't a white light like that one later in the 90s, but it was actually a purple light on the corner of the triangle, and it was not just sitting stationary, but it was rotating very slowly. He said he watched it spin for a minute or two. He ran into his parents' room and woke them. They came back into the bedroom, and they saw it go back over their yard, over the treetops. The parents got a short glimpse of it, and this was the first time he'd ever seen like anything. And he said there were some similarities between both experiences, but some differences as well. Now, I had asked him during the show if he thought he'd been abducted, and he said it's something that he thinks about. He said that was actually another incident that later involved he and his wife. He said originally he thought it was a dream, but he's not sure anymore. He said the power went out at their house, and it's very hot in the summertime there in South Carolina. And his parents were out of town, so they went over to their house, which had air conditioning, to keep cool. And this was around 10 or 11 at night, and they hadn't been there long. They went downstairs, pulled the couch out in the downstairs living room, and laid down. Now, he was asleep, but his wife told him this story, that they were lying there, and all of a sudden she saw this bright flash of light outside the windows. She heard rumbling, remember rumbling for the previous story, and it shook the entire house. She said there was light shining into the house like it was daytime. She became hysterical and was trying to wake him, but he wouldn't wake up. And it's very unusual for him because he's a very light sleeper. All of a sudden, she was asleep and woke up the next morning. He said, I can't deny that there have been some very strange experiences that I've encountered in my lifetime. So you have somebody here with 3 distinct incidents, 2 that he was conscious for, and with other people in the room. And I think maybe when you said there's something very interesting about this, I wonder if it might be the idea of these people who are visited time after time after time. It is fascinating.
But the thing that actually amused me about this story is that the first part of the story that he's telling, they see the UFO. And then the father leaves the 2 kids there to take the mother
home. Yeah. You stay here, kids. Like, they wouldn't abduct you or anything.
So are they an offering? I don't.
Yeah. When they told me that, I'm like, I have 2 kids. One's 12 and one's 16. And that would not be my first reaction if we all saw a UFO as a family. You guys stay here while I go get the camera.
Yeah. I mean, it just struck me as odd.
Well, and kids were tougher back then, I guess.
Yeah, well, that may be too. At least the way that we did things was different, even if they weren't necessarily tougher.
Lots of sharp metal edges.
All right, let's see. Let's go back to a ghost story. Maybe a living ghost, because that was actually very interesting.
Yes, this is interesting because we tend to think of apparitions as apparitions of the dead. But this is maybe an apparition of the living. Now, this was back way back in 1974 when I was still a very small child. So you know it's a long time ago. And Yvonne from the UK was having a baby, and she was at the Doncaster Royal Infirmary. And apparently all the mothers-to-be were told that they were going to go to the hospital theater, the cinema, to watch a film of babies being born to help them feel at ease with the whole process. But first they were going to have a rest period. And all of a sudden during this rest period, there was a face in front of hers that appeared, and she couldn't believe it. She said it looked like an old man, old woman, but the features were like a man with long hair. So she thought it was a woman. So really, she wasn't sure of the sex of this entity. And then this face, this person, said in a broad Irish accent, and I can't do an Irish accent, so I apologize, "Tell Colette I can't come over. I can't move my legs." And this, whatever it was, said it twice. And she rang the bell, and a nurse came, and she explained what had happened. And the nurse said, "We haven't got a Colette. I think you might have been dreaming." But it did upset Yvonne a little bit, and she took the rest period and went to sleep. And then they went downstairs to watch the movie. When they came back, they called over and said, "Yvonne, can you explain to me exactly what you what you've seen and how it came across?" And she said the same thing. "I think it was Colette. Tell Colette I can't move my legs and I can't come over." And with that, they said, "We've just received a telegram, but it was for Colleen, and it's the lady in the next bed." So not Colette, but Colleen. "And it's from Ireland, and it's her grandfather. He said that he can't come over because he's got thrombosis in both legs." And then they showed me the picture of the grandfather, Yvonne says. And it was exactly how I described it to the nurse. She said it was unbelievable because this man wasn't dead at all. He was well alive. She said she couldn't explain it all. You assume if you see an apparition, then it's a person who died. And again, when she saw the picture, it looked like a lady, but quite a masculine looking lady with very long gray hair. She said there's no way she could have ever seen this picture before. And she did get the name slightly wrong. But having said that, Colette was a lady who was having a baby as the same time that she had her first child. So it's possible that name stuck in her mind, but she could never really explain that. And it reminds me of a story that just a few months ago, I heard from Lloyd Auerbach, who is professor paranormal and really probably one of the most knowledgeable people about the paranormal, the supernatural, and parapsychology. And he told me a story where he had been doing something for the old TV program. I believe Sightings was the show. And there was a case where there had been a man who had killed somebody in a house, a crime scene, and he was convicted of it. And this scene kept replaying in this house. People would report seeing this killing, like, replay itself. But the interesting thing is the man wasn't dead. He was serving, I believe, a life sentence, or either he was on death row. But at the time people were reporting this, the man was very much alive, but they were seeing a replay. So again, it gets into that high strangeness. Really, are we putting things into these boxes like ghosts, like their spirits of the dead people, because that's what we can relate to? But the reality must be much wider and more unrestrained than we're giving it credit for.
Yeah, yeah, because we need some sense of control that everything is, you know, even if it's something weird, it's something weird we sort of understand.
Right, exactly.
I don't think we fully understand the way we interact with our own reality, and I think that's part of what causes us to have these high strangeness, things that wouldn't be so high strange if we understood them, of course.
Right, right, exactly. And I think that sometimes we're like a radio receiver that quite doesn't have the station tuned in, and we're kind of missing. Well, it's the old was the allegory of the cave, you know.
Yes, yes.
And I think that very much explains our condition. We're like, we're chained to the wall. We're seeing these shadows on the wall of a cave, and we're interpreting them in a certain way. But we're unchained. We're chained. We can't see the truth.
Yeah, yeah. All right, we got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with Jim Harold.
Where Did the Road Go can be heard first and usually live on WVBR, Saturday nights at 11 p.m. Eastern. Go to wheredidtheroadgo.com to ask questions of our live guests through the chat room. Where Did the Road Go is then re-aired on Dark Matter Radio and Deprogrammed Radio. You can download all shows for free on the website, and you can subscribe to us on Stitcher, iTunes, YouTube, or Vimeo. Additional content can be found on our video channels. You will also find our upcoming schedule, book reviews, blogs, free book downloads, links, and more. We are also on Facebook and Twitter, and if you want to help support the show, there are links to donate to us. Everything you need can be found at wheredidtheroadgo.com.
And we're talking with Jim Harold and talking about his new book, True Ghost Stories, number 4.
Mm-hmm.
And tell people where they can find you online before we continue.
Yes. If you're interested, you're obviously listening to this fine program, so you love supernatural paranormal radio. If you would like to listen to my podcast, you can just go to jimharold.com, J-I-M-H-A-R-O-L-D.com, and hit play and listen there. Or if you are an app person, a smartphone person, and most of us are these days, if you have an iPhone, you can certainly find us on the podcasts app and just add us there and listen to our free shows free of charge. And if you're an Android person, go to jimharold.com. There's a link there where you can actually download my free Android app. And you can listen that way. So we try to be equal opportunity provider. People with all different platforms can listen: computer, smartphone, iPad, tablet, whatever it is. We want to make it available in as many ways as we possibly can.
Nice. All right. Let's go back to another ghost story. How about our little ghost girl?
Our little ghost girl. Now, this is interesting because we've had callers who have had experiences in Japan, and usually people who are stationed there, the family stationed there for the military. And this was the case for Kelly from Tennessee. And this was 2008. Her family was stationed in southern Japan, and they decided they wanted to live in a Japanese home versus one on base. So they moved into a home, and interestingly, it was a newer home built in the early 2000s. And when they first moved in, they said they would hear footsteps like those of a child running. But they just thought the houses were built really closely together in Japan and the walls weren't well insulated. So they thought it was the neighbor kids. And she said her little girl at the time was just 2, and she was pregnant with her second child. So again, she thought it was the kids next door, but she would get spooked when she would actually go to sit outside. She said the summer after she moved in, her friend, who lived about a block from them, started having some strange things happen in her house as well. She said that she was there one night at her friend's house, and she heard someone say, "Mommy." And it wasn't just her heard it. She said it was her friend and 6 other people in the house who heard it as well. They thought it was one of her kids, so they looked, but they weren't anywhere near where they heard this voice. She said, fast forward about a year and a half ahead, and they were still hearing these footsteps in their own home. One night, she had a dream that she had 3 girls. Now, by this time, her second had been born, but they didn't have 3. She woke up the next morning, went to her girls' room, and she was confused because there weren't 3 girls in there. There were just 2, and she said she was confused. She went to her husband. She said, "Where's our other little girl?" And he said, "Well, we don't have another." So it was really messing with her mind. Now, in this dream, this vivid dream, the little girl in the dream was about the same age as her older daughter. And at about that same time, her daughter started telling her and her husband about a dream she kept having, about a little girl who would come and visit in her room, and they would play. Now, she assumed that she'd been listening to her older daughter talk about this dream, and she was dreaming about the same thing. One day, her husband called for her older daughter, and she didn't come. He looked up and thought he saw her standing and coloring at her little chalkboard. He said, "Honey, why aren't you paying attention to me?" This girl completely ignored her. Then he looked at her on the chalkboard and then looked at her youngest daughter, who was sitting on the floor. And then, to their surprise, the oldest daughter, the real daughter, walked out of the living room to the left. It hadn't been either of their real daughters coloring on the chalkboard at all. Now, her husband, who is a sailor and very much through and through, very level-headed, very analytical, he said he was just stunned by what he saw next. He said that he went and sat down because he was so stunned. He said there was another little girl, a third little girl, standing there with dark hair, just like their daughters. And she was the same height, but she wasn't one of their girls. And she thinks it all revolved around their oldest daughter. She was 4.5 or 5 at the time. A week later, she said she sent her older daughter upstairs to get something out of the bedroom. And she was taking her sweet time, and she yelled up the stairs, "Come on, let's go." And she heard footsteps coming down the bedroom to the top of the steps. They came down the steps, and she didn't hear anything. She figured her daughter had stepped off to the hardwood floor into the carpet where you enter the living room. She said, "Come on, let's go." Nothing happened. She walked out of the bathroom, which was on the other side of the house, and she said, "Where were you?" She said, "I didn't go upstairs yet, Mommy." So obviously, they're hearing this other little girl. Another night, they were sitting at dinner, and they looked up, and there was somebody walking down their hallway, child height. Her girls, her real girls, were with her, the two girls, and so were some children that were there with a friend. All of the children were accounted for except for the ghost girl. And she actually told her mom about this when they were about to move back to the States. Her mom said, "Please don't bring her home with you." And she said, "I'll do my best." And she said after she left, it seemed that her friend, who had been having odd experiences, called and said, "I think your little girl is at my house." It appeared that this little girl started hiding things. And they don't know who this girl could have been. Now, they said they were in southern Japan, and they visited some of the different sites there. I'm assuming maybe some of the spiritual sites and so forth. And her friend has a theory that something follows to home. And she said, "Why not? I had two girls. What's one more?" So that's the story of the little Japanese ghost girl.
Yeah, that's definitely an odd one.
Yeah.
That's the type of one where I look at and go, okay, is it actually what it seems like it is, or is it something else entirely, pretending to be a little Japanese girl?
Well, that's the thing. You know, we talk about this all the time. One of the things that scares me almost as much or more than anything is the whole idea of Ouija boards. And we just had a caller last night on a story that hasn't been aired yet for the Campfire and said, "Well, I had a good experience with a Ouija board," and he told the story and it seemed very pleasant, which is very unusual. Usually I get the stories of, "Oh, this is a horrible thing." But I always wonder, when you open a door like that, you don't know who's going to walk in. And again, I think that the whole idea, you know, if there are, quote, evil spirits out there, they're probably, I would assume there's some pretty sharp ones, and probably some that would know to masquerade. So I do worry about that. How many times do we think that we're talking to Aunt Millie, and maybe we're talking to, like, you know, Steve the demon?
And I don't think it's Ouija boards themselves. I think those just become focus items.
Sure.
That people can use to focus energy, and that's what happens with it. Because I've heard all kinds of stories of Ouija boards, good and bad. You know, you had one in your book, actually, that was pretty amusing.
Yeah, that may be the one about the Ouija board that kind of walked. Actually, the Ouija board supposedly walked across the room inchworm style, and they tried to burn the board.
No, it was the one where it sent them down to the corner and said they were going to die.
Oh, yeah, and then they basically sent these kids on a wild goose chase to kind of, you know, meet fate, and then they came back, and it literally laughed at them, went, "Ha, ha, 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 ha." And I do think there's probably, you know, my guess is that the spirit world, and this is what I've heard from many psychics I talk to, is that they're good spirits out there, and if people were good in this life, they're probably good over there, and if they were mischievous and kind of nasty over there, over here, they'll be the same way over there. It's not like, you know, you go over there and you get your angel wings.
And you see the trickster thing going through,
yes,
every aspect of the paranormal.
And the question to me is, Sarai, and I'm sure you've thought about this, is the idea, I've always looked at these things as very siloed, like, you know, ghosts here, UFOs here. Some people loop in something like Bigfoot, even though I'm pretty skeptical about Bigfoot. But, you know, you look at somebody like Stan Gordon, who's done the work with UFOs and the coincidence of of Bigfoot with UFO sightings, and then of course the work of people like John Mack. So you get, first of all, are there interconnections between the quote unexplained in different categories, and is some of it, you know, I had Nigel Kerner on the show who says that aliens are not biological but more mechanical and are trying to steal our souls. Now, I don't know that I agree with that, but maybe these different things that we are seeing are not as easily explained. You know, maybe a gray alien is not necessarily a gray alien. Maybe a ghost is not necessarily a ghost. Maybe it's something we're not even thinking about. Maybe some of this stuff is connected.
Yeah, and I mean, if you see a light in an old house, it's a ghost. If you see a light in the sky, it's a spaceship.
Right.
I mean, it's all interpretation as well. Plus, you know, when you look at like the whole alien concept, I don't think there's a lot of evidence for the extraterrestrial hypothesis. I mean, it would have to encompass why, say, shamans have experiences in altered states with gray aliens, why DMT, you know, people see gray aliens, why there are similar after effects from near-death experiences and alien abduction experiences. I mean, there's so many little things that just don't support the idea that they're extraterrestrial, but something entirely different.
Yeah, I mean, there's some people that believe all this stuff is the work of the devil or demons. Well, sure. that are just pulling one big hoax on us, one big trick, and messing with our minds. I'm not saying that I necessarily agree with that, but that's certainly a school of thought out there.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And with that, let's go into the man in red.
Now, this is a weird one, and I don't really know what to make of this, because I was worried about a screen memory or something like that with this. But this is from Jocelyn from Florida, and she said that the man in red started to visit her when she was about 9 years old. She said she lived in an apartment complex with her mom, her brothers, and sisters. And she said it was a very odd thing. She said a man in red would always come around 3 or 4 in the morning. She'd hear the door open. Their doors were always locked at night. Her mom would never leave anything open. She could see the hallway light because it was an apartment building, and she'd see the door open, and all of a sudden she'd see the light come into the apartment and hear heavy thumping footsteps coming into the living room. She said a strange man would sit on the small couch that her mom had in the living room. He'd just sit there for maybe a half hour. She said she was scared to death as she was only 9 years old. And right when he was about to turn his head and look towards her bedroom, she would close her eyes, count to 10, start praying, and after a little while, he'd be gone. And she said that happened all the way until she turned 13. Now, she says she's convinced this wasn't a person. She thinks it was some entity of some type. Mm-hmm. It was really tall, about 7 feet, very creepy, obviously. And after a while, she started to tell her mom about, but she would always say it was in her head. Then her younger sister started having nightmares, and she said that she would see the same figure coming in around 3 in the morning. And it sounded a little too familiar for Jocelyn, so she started asking a lot of questions. They'd stay up late at night and try to see if he would come, and he would. And eventually, not only did his younger sister see it, but her friends that would sleep over saw him too, apparently. He said that he'd just wander around, sit on the couch. Once he would turn his head towards the bedroom, they'd all scream and tuck underneath the blankets. She said the man wasn't the classic picture of the devil with the red face and all that, but he wasn't what she'd call normal either. Well, he's red. he was really tall, really lanky. And when he tried to come into a room, he'd have to bend over. That's how tall he was. He said you could tell it wasn't a normal person. He had a cloak like an old monk's cloak, but it was huge, like a really deep red, almost a burgundy color. He kind of floated, so he didn't walk normally. She said that her brothers and sisters experienced a lot of activity in the house growing up. They try things like trying to capture recordings via tape recorder. She said she even contacted a priest in Vatican City who wrote back to them and was very nice. He apparently sent the archbishop to her house, they said, and he blessed the home. But still, they always had strange activity in the house. She said if her mom tried to light a candle, it would explode. Things would come up missing. So she said she hasn't seen this figure in a long time. But she says they have activity every now and then. It's not as severe as when she was younger. And she wonders if anyone else out there has seen the man in red. Now, this sounds totally out there. But I don't really know how to explain it. It's just one of those, I put this in the head scratcher category.
But it also doesn't sound made up.
No.
Like it's almost too weird. Like if you want to make up a story, you're going to make up something more believable.
Right. And the thing is that, and I'll say this, the thing somebody might think was maybe she was imagining these things. Maybe this is a mental issue or something. But if you believe the story, other people were seeing it and validating it and having similar experiences. I mean, it reminds me of the story I told you before about the leprechaun. I mean, how do you explain that? I don't know how you explain that. Just like, you know, I had a story not too long ago of a woman who said that she had an out-of-body experience when she was sick. When she was sick as a teenager, I think, she said she floated down the street and went to a cute boy's house and went in his bedroom and saw him eating these huge candy bars. So once she got better, she wanted to validate this. So she went over to his house, found some excuse to go over to his house. And his mom was bringing in groceries. And all of a sudden, she brings in these huge candy bars that are exactly the kind that he was eating when she supposedly said, I mean, how do you explain that? I mean, either, and I told her this, either somebody is lying or something very unique has happened. I mean, that's kind of how I see it. In a case like that one, either, and I said, I don't believe you're lying, but either there are two explanations, you're lying or something really, really damn strange happened.
Well, it sounds like an out-of-body experience.
Yeah, it was.
So, let's go into the shadow people territory with a weird, wonderful West Virginia.
Yeah, this is really a strange one. And I'll try to condense this a little bit. This happened when our caller was 8 years old, David, who now lives in Oregon. And it turns out his family had lived in northeastern Ohio, which actually is where I live. And strangely enough, he moved to West Virginia, where my family was originally from. So I thought that was kind of an interesting bit of synchronicity there. And they became what he called urban Appalachians. So they kind of transplants. So anyway, they ended up going to this kind of very more or less rundown part of the country. In this particular area. And he kind of relates that in the story. He moved into a home that was about a half mile down the creek from his uncle Walker, his father's eldest brother who found the house for them. So anyway, they were living in this house and they start going to school and their classmates kept asking them, did they see any ghosts in their new house? And, you know, these kids were from Ohio, so they kind of, he kind of said they basically looked down on these kids, thought they were culturally backwards, and said, no, we hadn't seen any ghosts, and they asked him to please knock it off, but they kept being persistent. Have you seen any ghosts in your house? And he said they could truthfully say no until one day that they'll always remember. Now, apparently, their parents had gone into town to shop, and it was a day that he said he remembers very well. Afternoon, he was 8, his brother was 10, and the older sisters who had stayed behind with them were 13 and 14. They were sitting in the living room watching TV and playing a board game. And their dog, who was very protective, began barking hysterically, and to an extent that they'd never heard. He and his brother jumped up to the front door. He said they were like the family's little men. So they ran up to the front door to look out the door, thinking that either a human or a bear was about to come into the yard. And believe me, down there, you could see bears. That's not uncommon. So anyway, he said they looked out the door towards the direction the dog was barking. Outside, standing at the corner of the house, was a figure. And they could only see his front half. His back half was around the corner of the house. He said that he was standing as straight as a soldier, and it was obvious that it was a human figure. They thought it was a person there, knowing that the dad of the family wasn't home, attempting to play some sort of game with them in some way. They yelled at him and said, "We have a gun and we'll use it." And apparently they did have guns, and it was a strictly verbatim for them to play with it, but they were kind of afraid and they wanted to kind of get this across. And one of the sisters came back with the bedroom with a gun in her hand. And when it got to the door, this thing moved away from the house. It moved down the gravel driveway, and its shape, and I get this, was reminiscent of what you would describe with a rain slicker with a full body rain cap. The figure was something you would see like a silhouette of a New England-style fisherman-type outfit. It was completely flat black. There was no reflection off of it whatsoever. And he said this was not a shadow or an optical illusion. All three of them saw it. And as it moved from the house, it was floating above the ground and down the gravel driveway. He said their dog was following it with his eyes as well, barking at it. And it was floating. He said there were no feet that were obvious, and it wasn't making any sound whatsoever. And when it reached the end of the driveway, it made a right-hand turn at the bushes where they met the road. Now, they were completely in shock after this event. And when their parents and other sister got home, they told them what happened. Their mother believed them, but her dad didn't. He was very much a salt-of-the-earth kind of pragmatic guy. His opinion is that they just saw something that was explicable. Now, that was enough, but the story continued. 2 weeks later, after they'd all gone to school, their mom used to like to sit on the front porch in the mornings. And anyway, she was sitting on a front porch and saw the same figure. She said it came out of the ground where the roadway met the driveway. And instead of going down the driveway like they'd seen, it came up the driveway towards the house. And when they saw it, it looked like a stick figure almost moving down the driveway. There was no body motion. Their mom said that when she saw it coming up the driveway, it was very animated, running as if kicking its legs up very high, moving the garment that it had over. She thought it was going to come up the steps, but it proceeded past the corner of the house. She said that it was also floating above the ground about a foot. So that's consistent. It was not touching the ground. And when she told him this, they thought, yes, we know. he said those kids they thought at school were so culturally backward. They weren't as backward as we thought they were, because they obviously were onto something that we hadn't known. Now, another thing happened about 2 weeks after their mom's experience. It was nighttime. Pretty much everybody was in bed. And all of a sudden, there's all kinds of these noises coming from their attic, which had no furniture in it except for an ironing board with an iron sitting on. Incredible noises coming from the attic, David said. And apparently, his dad started to go up the steps with a handgun, threatening whoever was up there, said, who's ever's up there? I'm giving you one chance to get out. I'm armed. I'm coming up the steps. I'm giving you one chance to get out. He tried to fire the gun when it didn't come out. The gun jammed. They went up, and there was actually nothing whatsoever up in the attic. Now, David said that he's an almost 50-year-old person, and he said it was a very formative part of his development as a child. He said, I stuttered partly, I think, because of this incident until I was 13 years old. He said, these events traumatized me as a child. And he said, to this day, it's a very impactful part of my history. And it all happened in West Virginia.
Nice. Yeah, that's definitely a weird one.
Yeah, and the fact that it happened again and again and yet again, all kind of involving different members of the family. So eventually, pretty much everybody was touched by it.
Yeah, yeah. Let's hit another two or three of these before the end, and then we'll do a couple of for our patrons.
Okay, sounds good.
Let's see. Let's do Fairy Fire. This one's
This is really unique. And the thing that struck me about this, we talked about this earlier about somebody being very sincere, and I got the feeling when I talked to this woman, and my guess is that she was in her 50s or 60s, extremely sincere. I didn't feel that she sleeps with a pyramid under her bed or anything like that. Nothing wrong with that. But I really got the feeling of true sincerity with her. This is Evelyn from Arizona. And she said this story revolves around a time when her next door neighbor invited her husband and he to join them for dinner at a local restaurant. And they went out and had dinner. And the neighbors invited them to come back to their house for coffee and dessert. Now, one thing Evelyn was very clear on, no alcohol was consumed during this dinner or afterward. Now, it was a very hot day in June, so they ended up going over to the house for dessert. Now, they left early, about 8:45 p.m., because her husband works remotely with a company on the East Coast. So he had to get up pretty early the next morning with a couple hour time difference. So anyway, it's only about, their houses are only about 200 feet across. So they began the quote, long trek back home. She said it was a pitch moonless night. And she says they live in a suburban kind of rural area and they couldn't see anything in front of us. But she had a little flashlight attached to her keychain so they could see. So they went down the asphalt driveway. Their friend's asphalt driveway is lit with solar lights. So they found their way. And on the other side was a little dirt road that led to their house. And she said, as soon as they got on the road, they heard a rustling beside them on the right. And now on her left was a huge cattle ranch with a cow pasture. The cows weren't around that week, so she didn't think it was a cow walking along with them. She said she was terrified by the sound, and when they stopped moving, the rustling also stopped. She seemed like something was walking alongside her, but again, it wasn't the cows. She used her little flashlight and she didn't see a thing, so she was clinging to her husband for dear life. She was terrified, and her husband knew it. But then he said, "You think that's scary? Look at the ground." So Evelyn did. Now, this is a dirt road she's on. But what she saw, she wasn't prepared for. The ground had turned a fluorescent green. Green, like a neon sign green. She said, we were beside ourselves because we'd never seen anything like this. We had no idea what it was. She said, both of us were extremely focused on walking straight and getting home. She said, the green fluorescent rocks on the road continued to be green until we reached the house. The whole road was green. It was like we were following a fluorescent green road like the yellow brick road in The Wizard of Oz. Again, she reiterated. We had nothing to drink, no alcohol, none of us were drugged, nothing like that. She said the only thing they had to drink was a fruit iced tea, and that was it. They weren't on any types of medication, she said. So she said when they approached their house, they had a motion detecting light that was always on very dimly, and as someone approaches the light, it gets brighter. Well, for some reason, that night, the light was totally off. No one turned it off, it was on all the time, but the light didn't work that evening. In fact, it never worked again after that night. She said they were so glad to reach her house with no incident. They had no explanation what was rustling, walking around with us, and what caused the fluorescent green rocks on the road. And she said they have friends who own a metaphysical shop in Bisbee, Arizona. Of course, that famous ghost town. And they told them what happened. And their friend smiled and said, you encountered fairy fire. And they looked at each other and they said, what is fairy fire? Now, according to these metaphysical shop owners, they explained that it's an old Scottish folklore that fairies were some sort of beings and they tried to lure weary travelers by using this fairy fire. They were trying to lure them into their dimension and their world by the sound of the rustling and the fluorescent green rocks in the road. Now, she was told if they had stopped to pick up a rock or had gone ahead to investigate what the rustling was, they would have fallen into their dimension. Lucky for them, they were so focused on getting home that their energy overcame theirs. That was the explanation. So I don't know if it was fairy fire, but I know it was weird.
True, true. And if someone did disappear into their dimension, how would we know?
Well, that's interesting. I mean, that brings up the work of somebody like David Paulides and so forth. You know, people that are missing. Now, obviously, a lot of people who are missing, you know, maybe fall into some kind of like fall over a cliff or something, and particularly in the national parks, you know, just very natural but unfortunate and tragic things. Some people are abducted by evil, mean, sick people. That happens, of course. But it seems like there's a third category of, well, they don't fit either one of those explanations. What in the world happened to these people? And sometimes you wonder, what do happen to some of these missing people?
Are these the close calls that we're talking about right now?
Yeah, exactly.
I noticed, like, in a lot of Paulides's work, the people who disappear the last time anyone sees them, they're kind of like looking off in the distance at something.
Yeah, yeah, it's really interesting stuff that he does, and it does make you think, and that's why I kind of agree with you. I think there's just a whole part of this picture, and it might be 98% of the picture that we're not seeing. Yeah. And it's something that's real. And that's when we talk to the folks that are very materialistic. And I don't mean they like to own a lot of stuff. I mean, scientific materialism and those kind of things. I think what irritates me sometimes, and I love science and I think it's great. And I think skepticism is often called for. But sometimes what irritates me is that they don't realize that we're all walking around with blinders, I think, to some extent, yeah, through no fault of our own, but we have these blinders and we can't see the whole picture.
Yeah, our senses just don't pick up that much. I mean, we think it picks up everything, but the reality is there's so much around us that we are completely blind to.
Exactly.
And who knows what else is out there that we don't even know exists. Beyond, I mean, we could say, you know, infrared exists, right, and infrasound exists, but there could be levels of things that we just simply have no concept
of. Well, I'll give you a very kind of, I guess, mundane example. DNA. In 1900, did anybody really know that DNA existed? No.
Yeah.
But it did exist, and it just took us another, you know, almost however many decades to discover it and then map the genome and so forth and so on. Now, it's existed for the entirety of humanity, but nobody knew right. anything about it. So just because we don't know about something or even have an inkling of it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It just means that we don't have the capability within our senses or the tools that we have to gather data to detect it.
Yeah, exactly. All right, let's see. Let's do UFO rendezvous.
Yeah, UFO rendezvous. This was from Mike from Florida. Now, this is kind of wild because this is literally a UFO rendezvous, and this happened in my home state of Ohio. This gentleman worked in Columbus, and he would typically get off of work at 11:30 or midnight. And he said for about 3 or 4 weeks, several of his coworkers and he had seen different lights that flew around in set patterns, and they thought it was strange. So one night as he was driving home, he said he was going to find out what these lights were. So he headed west from Columbus in the direction where these lights had been appearing. He said looking out of his windshield, there were three lights. One of them was on the left side of his field of vision, and it would drive in this particular or fly around in this particular pattern. It kept repeating this pattern. And then the second light had a different kind of pattern. And the third light was on the right side of his field of vision, and it was kind of doing an up and down pattern, just like the light on the left side. So for some reason, he decided he was going to try to figure out what they were. So he decided on his way home that he was going to flash his headlights on high beam every time he turned towards the direction of these lights. And he said about 30 minutes into his drive, he was just about 10 minutes from his house, he said, once the light on the right side reached the top of its travel and would start to come down, it would start to get bigger. So he took it to mean that it was coming towards him. So he decided that he was going to pull off a little access road near a farm, and he was going to sit there with his bright lights on. He said he sat there, and the light got bigger and bigger. And he started to notice it had a shape to it. And he got out of his car to watch whatever this was come towards him. He said he didn't have a good frame of reference because there wasn't anything around him. It was an open field. But he said that the thing looked to be 30 or 40 feet long. He said it was probably about 150 feet above his car. And he said it was really odd. It was like a teardrop or a raindrop lying on its side. Now, by this time, it was between 12 or 12:30. It was a full moon out with not a cloud in the sky. And he said I had a perfect view of this thing. He said the round part of this object was facing east, and the tail of it tapered to what looked like to be a point to me. The moon was shining on it, so he couldn't see the surface, but the very tip of it. He said it was either a black or a dark gray, something like this. He said the thing had wings like an airplane, and they were kind of swept back at maybe a 45-degree angle. It didn't have a tail section like a regular airplane would. The tail just came to a point. On the leading edge of each wing, and this is very detailed, I must say, on the leading edge of each wing, there were what he thought were windows. There were 6 to 8 round yellow dots that looked like they were illuminated from within the tip of each wing, and on the tip of the front of this thing, there looked to be stationary spotlights. They shone down towards the ground, but the lights didn't quite reach. He said he left his car with his radio lights on just to see if it would cause anything to happen in the car, because we know in many UFO abduction cases and so forth, somebody's in a car and then it just stops. He said in this case, it was fine. And he said it didn't seem to affect it at all. He says the thing went over his car, and that's interesting. You know, basically rendezvoused with him. He said there was no sound. He said he watched it go over his car and behind him a bit. And he turned around to see what the other two lights were doing, because remember, there were three objects, and they were doing their same thing. He said he turned back to where this object was and was totally gone, as though it disappeared. Now, he said at that time he didn't know anything about stealth blimps or that kind of stuff because he was pretty new to this type of thing. He said he just knew it had wings, which he thought were kind of odd. It didn't have a tail section, which was weird, and it didn't make any noise. He said, I didn't know what it was then, and I don't know what it is now. Interestingly enough, west of Columbus is Dayton, which is where Wright-Patterson Air Force Base is located. And that's the westerly direction where these things look like they were coming from. He said, "This thing flew over my car and disappeared. I stood there for a while and searched her horizon from the west side to side and couldn't see anything but the stars and the moon. So I got in my car and drove home. The rest of the way, I never saw that third light again. I just saw the other two lights going through their little pattern. Maybe a week or so later, the lights just disappeared, and I've never seen them since." So, I mean, take it for what it's worth, but quite a unique UFO story.
Yeah, yeah. And if those are the ones that always make me think there's some kind of government
activity. Well, you know, I don't think it necessarily has to be an either or, right? I mean, Annie Jacobson did a very interesting book on Area 51 and talked about some of the UFO sightings from the 50s. And if you think about it, some of those planes that they were testing, you know, even if a professional pilot, like an airline pilot, would see them, well, of course they would say, well, that's doing things a conventional aircraft wouldn't do because they weren't conventional aircraft. So I definitely think there's a percentage of UFO sightings that are absolutely governmental activity. I don't think there's any question about that. That I don't think that precludes the idea that there might also be some in the other category.
Certainly.
But I think that there's a large percentage that could be government activity, even more so now. I used to do a show, a video show. Well, we do the Paranormal Report with Micah Hanks, and I know you know Micah well, and he's been on the show, and we kind of restarted that as an audio podcast, and we do a little live thing every couple of weeks. But we stopped doing the clips because now, you know, there's so many drones and fake UFO clips and those kind of things that I think we both thought that kind of lost its appeal because you really can't, you know, YouTube, for example, is flooded with this stuff and you can't really tell what's a drone and what might actually have something to it or what might actually just be an out and out fake. So we thought maybe that part of the show kind of lost its value. So that's why we stopped doing it in video.
All right, let's do one more quick one here, and let's end with a ghost story. Let's do ghost workers.
Ghost workers. Now, this is interesting because I actually kind of know where this is at. This is in Canton, Ohio. It used to be a manufacturing plant for a large vacuum corporation, and this is Neil from Ohio. And he ended up working there after this company left, and there were other companies that kind of took the space over after having been a huge vacuum factory for many, many years. He said one Saturday morning he went in and he was there by himself as the person on the previous shift have left. He said he went out to his job area and he's walking about 50 yards when he heard somebody walking beside him. He looked and there was nobody there. He said he started walking again and he heard footsteps again. And then he stopped and those footsteps took off like somebody was just ran away from him. He said he was getting squirrely. He was hearing little conversations going on. And he couldn't place them. He figured it must have been from one of the other plants in the building. But he said the strangest thing happened was once he went back to his office and walking back to his office, he was going down the aisle and at the corner, there was an intersection coming up to him. There was an office that had windows on three sides, and he looked through two of them in an angle to the oncoming aisle that he was walking towards, and he said he saw a guy walking towards him like he was going to meet him at the corner. He looked at this man looked at him and smiled. He had blonde hair, a striped shirt, and Neil wondered, who's this? He'd never seen him there before. Well, he got to the corner, and there was nobody there. Now, Neil notes that this place dates maybe back to the 1800s. It's massive. And he said at one time it had its own coal plant infirmary and was a self-contained community. And he said he hasn't verified anything, but he's doing some research. He said the most recent experience he had was when he was on the phone walking through an abandoned section of the plant. The production area is separate from the main office area. He was walking through the abandoned part talking to his mother on his cell phone. He lost signal and said, "Mom, can you hear me?" And then the line was dead. He heard garbled stuff, but it wasn't her, so he just hung up. Then he got a call a couple of hours from his mom saying, "How long did you hold on the phone?" He said, "Well, once you said so-and-so, I hung up." She said the line held for another 2 minutes. At one point, his mom said she heard somebody saying, I'm here, come get me, I'm here." Now, he said there have been tons of stories that have come from this because he talks to his coworkers and he asks, "Are you guys seeing this? Is this real?" He says he has many stories. He says one of his coworkers hears whistling. He'll be in the plant alone at night, and he'll hear somebody whistling to the point that it will aggravate him. He'll tell him to shut up, and it stops for about 2 minutes. Then it chimes up even louder in his ear. He said there's more to this strange old place than vacuums.
All right. So we have a few more that we don't have time for right now, but we're going to put it out for Patreons only. If you want to become a patron of the show, go to wheredidtheroadgo.com. It's only $3 a month, and you get little extras like this. But also, if you want to read all the stories, people can get your book where, Jim?
Well, it's really easy. I've actually set aside a special page on my website, and I've set up a special web address. It's really easy to get to, jimharoldbooks.com, J-I-M-H-A-R-O-L-D, books with an S, .com, jimharoldbooks.com. That'll actually take you to a page on my website that has links to all four books. And the nice thing about the books is you don't have to read them in any specific order. You can start with four and go backwards, or start right in the middle, whichever book kind of floats your boat. And also, if you want to just go to directly to Amazon, you can go to Amazon and search for Jim Harold, H-A-R-O-L-D, and I will pop up with my Campfire books. And each one of them has at one time or another been a number one bestseller in the supernatural category on Kindle. So they've been well received. And if you like ghost stories, I think you'll like them.